the craziest thing. I was dozing off a little bit. I came in early. I'd been up half of the night. I had to go to Jacksonville. Came in from London and Germany. Saw my husband for a quick minute. Flew to Jacksonville. Got up at 3:30 this morning. Got here at about 7 o'clock. Took a quick little nap and prayed. And then God began to deal with me the whole time before I got here. Now, this is the craziest thing. And so I was like, God, we're here to honor this great woman of God. He said, I want you to make sure you take this church to the next phase of where they need to go. So I thought that was kind of different. He says, your assignment is to take them to the next phase of where they need to go. So this could be maintained. So I was watching the playoffs, and the basketball playoffs, don't hate. And and Miami was in the playoffs, don't hate now. And they won, okay. And the whole time they were doing the playoffs, they kept talking about this dream team. This is the dream team. LeBron, Dwayne, Bosh, y'all know them, huh? I told you don't hate. So God spoke something to me. I want you to turn your Bibles to Isaiah 43 and 19 for a minute. Isaiah 43 and 19. And I'm going to try not to be before you long. I think this is going to be a blessing to you. And when you have it, say amen. Behold, I will do a new thing. Now it shall spring forth. Shall ye not know it? I would even make a way in the wilderness and rivers in the desert. Y'all getting this, huh? Look at the 21st verse. And these people who I have formed for myself, they shall show forth my praise. Now I want to show you something. I want to look at this from, I just love these computers. It says, be alert, be present, for I'm about to do something brand new. It's bursting out. Don't you see it? There it is. I'm making a road through the desert rivers in the Badlands. Wild animals will say thank you. The coyotes and the buzzards. Because I provide water in the desert, rivers through the sun-baked earth, drinking water for the people I chose, the people I made, especially for myself, a people custom-made to praise me. Y'all getting this? He said, even the buzzards, they gonna say thank you. So when God was giving me this scripture, and of course we've heard this before, God spoke to me. He says, I'm getting ready to do some things here. I'm going to retool, R-E-T-O-O-L, rethink, and refire. Retool, which means to revise or reorganize, especially for the purpose of updating improvement. God says, you know, we're going to these classes. They teach us that rich people don't buy cars and houses like what we do. So they gave me the website with a passcode because I qualify for it with a certain status. And going in there, what you do is you be looking at foreclosures all day. And so because you have monies and you don't have to finance, you could go and tell somebody to go to the auction and buy you a condo, two-bedroom condo on Miami Beach, that they start at $14,000. and walk away with it paying $14,000 and renovate it and then sell it for $600,000. But when you're looking at it at the level of $14,000, it don't have a brand new sink in it. The people who moved out, when they lose a house, they get mad, so they up the carpet, take the copper out, take the air conditioner, take the refrigerator. So in order for you to go in and buy something like that, you got to have a vision of how you is supposed to look, not how it looks now. So God says he's going to retool this place. He's getting ready to reorganize. He's getting ready to do a renovation on it. That what it looks like right now, you got to have a vision in order to stay here to know where y'all getting ready to go. So God says you're going through a season of retooling. Now, if you buy the place, we bought the condo for $14,000, and then you go in and you do an assessment, and you go in and say what it's going to cost, because the Bible tells you to count the cost. You see what it's going to cost to renovate it, and then you're able to go in and get the lowest and all that and get people to bid on it. They'll be bidding for you, and then you fix it all up. And once the renovation is done, unless you have a picture of how it used to look, there will be no signs of the old thing. And when people look at the way the condo look, they don't even ask you how it used to look. You know, they just tested my grandson and said that he was a genius, and I knew something was different for him because he didn't want to go to the park unless he go. He only wanted to go to the woods to see the trees. So he said, "Grandma, this is an oak tree right here." And he'll wake up, "Can I go see the trees?" And I'm thinking, who in the world want to see the trees? And then he don't want to go to the park and play on the swing. He want us to take him to rooms to go. So he goes in there, he'll look at the furniture, how they make it, and how they decorate it. And he said, "Now this is nice. Now this is not good. This is not made right. This is not good." And as my husband and I are looking at homes, he liked to go with us. We could go look at 10 homes. And he'll walk in, "Oh, look at the carpet. Look at the kitchen. Oh, it got marble. Look at the floors." And he's 5 years old. I'm like, "What? I want to know if the kitchen big enough for me to cook in a big closet so I can put all my shoes." Not him. He like, "This is not, look at this. Oh, look at this structure. This is nice." And we go to the house, "This is not good. This is not good, Grandma. Me, my, this is not a good house." And then when it ain't good, he said, "Next." He don't even want to see the rest of the house. He said, "Next." And then his favorite channel is the channel, you know, where they renovate homes and people buy homes. He would sit there and watch it. He said, "Oh, they got hardwood floors." And the Lord spoke to me. He says he's going to be an architect. He's got to be interested in it. I said, "Well, you know, we were coming up. We didn't know black people was architects." And so, and then his favorite show is Einstein, because it teaches you the different paintings and the different music. And he'll listen, "Bump, bump, bump, bump. Grab me, my, that's Bach." And then one day we went to somewhere, he told me, "Oh, look at Picasso. Oh, Picasso." I said, "Lord, you're on another level, okay? You don't want no doll. I mean, you know, you don't want to play with Chucky or somebody, a truck." "Here's Chucky, pray for Chucky." And so one of his favorite toys is, you know, when you get through with the aluminum foil, you have the roll. He'll take two of those and make sounds. Me and my, look at that. Woof, 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 woof. I say, you know, you come real cheap. You buy him expensive gifts, he don't want it. Except he loves his tablet and the computer. He will Skype you on his own. He said, Mima, he Skyped me. Don't tell my mama she acting up today. I need you to pray. Oh, she coming back. These kids are different now. And so, but the thing about it is that he recognized that when you go into a place that is the foundation is not right, he don't want to be bothered. Well, we're trying to build on a foundation that's not right. Because if your foundation is not right, whatever you build is going to be shady. So in order to repair that, the foundation, in Dallas they have a place called Las Colinas. And it's and the Asians own it, and they sold these multi-million-dollar homes to the people. But Las Colinas soil shifts on you after 5 years. So what they got to do is they got to build a strong foundation before they build a house to make sure that it could accommodate the shift. Now, those who didn't get that foundation, like one of my friends, her oven tilted. So she got to go back. There's no way to repair that except you got to go back and tear the thing down and build the foundation all over again. Because if you try to build something else on top of it, it ain't going to work. So God says, I'm about to retool some things. I'm causing revise and reorganization, especially for the purpose of updating and improvement. And that's what we got to understand, that when God shakes us, don't take it personal. Don't get upset when the woman of God repositioning things. It's for improvement. It's to bring you up to date. I don't know why I'm not in this position like I used to be. Honey, it's time to update. We're improving. Some of y'all don't want to get old, but you're getting old. And you got to prepare your next generation to take over. And it's not an indictment on you. It's even better for you when you have trained them properly. You know what they teach us in the financial class? They say there's a lot of people that's rich, but it's not too many people that's wealthy. Because, see, you could be rich, but wealth goes from generation to generation. Oh, come on now. So it's passed down from generation to generation. If I die, my children got to take financial classes so they'll know how to deal with the monies that is passed down to the next generation. It's not a testimony to God to build something, and when that person die, it's over. That's why he says, I wish that your fruit remain. Because it's hard to maintain it than it is to get it. So then the other word, as he says, is to rethink. Rethink means to reconsider. Colossians 3:15, and let the peace of God rule in your heart. And God's supernatural peace, it wants to dominate and govern every emotion and situation that confronts you. Worry and fear, any situation like that. Because when God is rethinking, he said, I want you to begin to rethink this whole situation again and stop being so emotional with it. Oh, they're overlooking me. No one can overlook you. Because when God made you, he customized you. And no one can accommodate what you're supposed to do because you're not a duplicate. So then he says, refire, which is to become inflamed with passion. Y'all, some of y'all lost your excitement. When I go to England, you know, English, British people, even though they're Africans, you can tell some of the Africans when they're raised in Britain, because British people are not really emotional. And you'll be preaching there, and they'll come to you, oh, prophetess, oh, my God, that was such a good word. Oh, praise the Lord. Hallelujah. Oh, I felt the power of God. And I'm looking like, you did? You ain't moved all night. So I went to this women's conference in England, and you usually need to study your culture when you go over there. So it's a well-known minister that y'all know. They were up speaking that night, her and her husband. So she get up there and she tell me, hey, y'all don't get with me. I'm going back to the hotel. They said, okay. They said, you want to go back to the hotel? Before you speak or after? Then her husband got up there to do the offering. And he was up there talking about, I want 500 people to give it to that. And they were just looking. And he was like, oh, y'all don't give? And they were looking like, what is he talking about? Why is he calling that line? And then when they get up and say, oh, y'all don't hear me, they say, yes, we do. And then if you go, hello, they say, hello. You got to know the culture. You're going to get frustrated. If you don't know the culture and you don't know how things work for that particular group of people, your messages won't even be dynamic. You got to know the culture of heaven. Because if you don't know the culture of heaven, then you won't miss it. You got to know how God operates. What he responds to and how he blesses. So when somebody comes with some other foolishness, you be like, well, that's not from my culture. And needless to say, they flocked there. I was cracking up. I said, you should have asked me. I've been coming here a long time. You should have asked me. Ha ha. Hello. Hello. See, when you're passionate, you won't easily be persuaded to give up. So you got to have this fire. This God wants to refire us. So you won't be quick to just give up. Boy, I mean, when I was taking care of my sister, I would go in the downstairs at the lake and just cry. God, this is so difficult, sitting up in a chair in the dark. It's only the grace of God. I just kept hearing God say, wipe your eyes and go back up there and sit. See, that's what you don't understand. That's when you're in a battle, you should get excited because the spoil is greater than the battle. So I want to show you something. As this began to happen, now this is what really messed me up. God wants us to retool. He wants to revise us. He wants to, which means to revise. He wants us to retool, rethink, and then refire. And he says, tell the people today, as y'all enter into this next phase, you'll think this is a New Year's Eve service. It's a New Year's Eve for you. He says, you saw what happened with the Miami Heat, the reason why they were successful, and they put emphasis on it, is because they had a dream team. Because nobody can do it by themselves. And each one of them has its own purpose. So God says, woman of God, I'm getting ready to form the dream team. Now, let me show you something about the dream team that really got me. What's a dream team? he said he's going to do a new thing. Look at somebody say he's doing a new thing. You ready for it? So God says you got to have a dream team. A dream team is a group of members who are among the most qualified or talented in their particular field. They're not a novice. Because when you have this, they'll be the ones that's able you to dispatch and train those who come in, that they will be next to be the dream team. So who's a part of this dream team? This will really mess me up. Now he says, know them that labor among you. The first person you have to have on a dream team is you got to have a mentor. Put on that mentor. That's somebody who know more than you. If you're in a group of people and you know more than the person, something wrong with that. Because that means all you know is what you know, and that's how far you're going to grow. You don't have no accountability to somebody who know more than you. A person who mentors you is someone that's smarter than you. Been there, done that. They can speak into your life, give you godly counsel. And there's no way you will be able to maintain what God has put on the inside of you without having a mentor. The second person in your team, you got to have a confidant. You got to have somebody who keeps secrets. They'll go to their grave. You got to have somebody that when you're going through stuff, you're frustrated, you just need to vent. They don't even have to answer you. They're able to listen to what you got to say and just let you get it out. And then when they finish, you don't judge the anointing that's on their life. I had to pay the cost for this. When you get this down packed, your life should be more successful than it ever been. You got to have somebody that you can go to and just pour out your heart with secrets. They'll pray for you and won't judge you. You can get it out. That's what's killing folks today in the church and outside the church. They're holding stuff in because they don't have nobody they could trust to let it out. Nobody to say I'm having thoughts of suicide. Nobody to say I'm looking at another woman and I know it's not right. Nobody to tell them, listen, come on and get it out. And they'll keep your secrets. And it won't be all over the church. The next person on your dream team, you got to have a coach. A person who keep you excited and encourage you. They see the good in you. All they do is say, oh, you can do it. Get on up here. Now, you can do this. Uh-huh. By the time you get through with them coaching you, you feel like you could jump off the top of the roof. Even though you can't, you just feel like it. Because they tell you, yes, you can. You can do this. You can do this. Come on, we're going to work out tomorrow. I'm going to come over to your house. I know you in there. Come on out of there. Come on, let's go. Let's go to walking. You breathing hard. Come on, we got another mile. We can do this. You got to have a coach who pushes you out of your comfort zone. And make you feel like there's nothing that you can't do and accomplish. And when you're giving them something that looks impossible, they don't look at you and say, I don't know how you're going to do that. You can do this, girl. Handle it. I know you could do this. You got to have a coach. Somebody that's pushing you. The next one is you got to have a friend who always tell you the truth. Even if it's hurt, they're going to tell you the truth. Girl, you know I love you, but honey, y'all going to let, I never forget, I was at this banquet, I was at this ball, and I had this nice dress on, it was with one of my friends, and I thought I was looking cute that night, and so I went to the restroom. I came back, everybody was looking at me. I said, they like this dress, and they were just staring at me. I said, this dress, and my friend Puma just said, girl! Your shirt, they can see your butt. I said, oh, Lord. A friend will let you know you got a booger hanging. Or your zipper down where everybody else is looking at you. A friend will let you know you're in your mess and you need to come out of it. Even if you get mad at them, they say, I know you're going to get mad, But you need to leave that woman alone. You need to leave that man alone. That's wrong. You know it's not right. And at the end of the day, you know they love you. They won't let you wallow in your mess. And you got to have somebody that will tell you the truth. Girl, you here's a man, honey. Your breath smelling today. Come on, here, get a man. You'll be surprised how many people let you walk around with your zipper down and won't say nothing. They'll tell other people, but they won't tell. That whole place saw my dress up in the air like that. I didn't pull it all the way down. They were just looking. Y'all know I left that event real fast. The next person on your dream team is, you got to have a Peter, an advocate. Got to have that Peter spirit. We're going to call it an advocate. Someone that fights for you when you can't fight for yourself. Someone who speaks in your behalf when you're not even around. Honey, you better not talk about my pastor. You talk about my pastor, you got to talk about me. Somebody who will cut the ear off and they don't even have the capability of putting it back. My husband and I went somewhere and the lady was talking to my husband any kind of way. I didn't even give a chance. I was like, wait a minute, you don't talk to my husband. He said, baby, I got this. Ah, you don't talk to my husband like that. Who you think? He said, baby, I got this. I said, no. He said, sit down. I got this. You need somebody who going to fight for you, that advocate. Well, why are pastor doing this? We don't know. Just shut your mouth and just let her do what God called her to do. And if you don't shut up, I'm about to cut your ears off. You don't know now. I always was Pentecostal. I'm from the Baptist church. We used to take people outside and beat them in the parking lot. That spirit ain't leave. Don't mess with me. Don't talk about my pastor. I used to love when Deacon Smiley would pick me up because he said, I love my pastor. Don't talk about my apostle now. And I love my apostle. You love to hear people say that. You got to have somebody that will fight for you. Because you can't. Sometimes you can't fight for yourself. And you just get up and say, y'all, who, what? Before you get to her, you got to get to me. So let's just see the ones we got now. First, you got to have a what? Second one? Third one? Fourth one? Fifth one? Advocate. The next thing is that you just got to have your play partner. Fun. Gotta have somebody that you don't talk about serious stuff. You don't want to get deep with them. You just want to play. You know, my husband would play video games with this guy for 3 years. He played video games with this guy every Monday. I said, honey, what's his name? He knew his name. I said, what's his last name? I don't know. I said, well, where did he live? I don't know where he lived. What did he do? I don't know. I said, how come you know? He said, because his purpose is just to come and play video games with me. I don't want to know his business. You got to have that time that you're not trying to be serious and so spiritual. When you go out with your friends and y'all just eat and laugh, not trying to be deep. But let me tell you about this revelation. I don't want no revelation right now. I'm trying to eat. You gotta have that person in your life that you could call and y'all could just hang out. You ain't gossiping about nobody. You ain't talking about nothing deep. They not trying to find out your business. You just shopping and then you wave at them and say, I'll see you next year. My husband got a friend in the Bahamas. And he ain't got no shame to his game. Don't talk to the man in 5 years. Call him when we get to Bahamas. Hey, Key, we at the airport. You going to pick us up? He come and pick him up. I said, you ain't even shame. He said, I like the low maintenance. He know I ain't gonna call him for another 5 years. He ain't got no other expectation. He know his purpose. Are y'all getting this? So you gotta have somebody that you play with. This is good, isn't it? The next one is, you gotta have a sponsor. You gotta have somebody that when you give the vision, they got the ideas how to get the money. You know what, Pastor? Or they got the connection. You ever been around somebody that said, I know somebody that you need to meet, and you meet them, and you give them a connection. They the sponsor. They the ones that they know how to, Pastor, tell us what you need. Okay, we know where to get the money from. I know somebody who's looking for somebody who gonna give you this. You gotta have somebody around you. They not only know how to connect you, but they got money. And they know how to write the check. You got to have a sponsor who's there to make sure they sponsor your vision. Whether they write a check or they connect you with somebody who can do it. To make sure the job gets done. Isn't this good? So you got to have a sponsor. Look at somebody and say, I got to have me a sponsor. Duh. So as we look at this, let's say the dream team again. What's the first one? Second one? Go ahead. Go ahead. Go ahead. Go ahead. And the last one is that you got to have an enemy, a Judas around. Got to have a Judas. The Bible says, know them that labor among you. You got to have him close to you. Because you know they talk a lot. You know they backbite. You know they're going to backstab you. So you use that to your advantage. So when you don't want to deal with a person, you tell Judas. You say, Judas, you know this between you and I. But you know Miss Sally, she don't ever pay tithes. And I'm just praying. It's frustrating me. But I know you ain't going to tell nobody. I ain't going to say nothing. Next Sunday, you see Miss Sally paying her tithes. Mission accomplished. Judas untold what you didn't want to say. You know Judas gonna tell everything, talk a lot. So you need everybody to know that the service is canceled on Wednesday. So you get on the phone and say, Judas, you know what, I'm thinking about canceling the service on Wednesday. In fact, I'm gonna cancel it. So you know, you the first one to know. I'll get back with you. Judas is a good PR person. Everybody in the church already know. This is what you don't understand. I want y'all to get this revelation here. We be trying to push people away from us, but we don't even know God put them in us. This is what you need. Also, it helps you to tame your mouth. Because with the other people you're comfortable with, because you know they're part of your team, with a Judas, you know that you got to be careful what you say. So then that way you become accountable to yourself, and it causes you to have self-discipline. And so you are able to discipline yourself because you know whatever you say to Judas is going to be all over the church. So it helps you to guard your mouth and guard your thoughts. And that's causing you to develop properly. So So you need Judas there. You need him there or her there, because you know what they're capable of doing. And you use it to your advantage. Now, let me tell you where the problem comes in with your life. When you make Judas your confidant, you want your mentor to be your friend. You got Peter to be your coach. Peter used to tell people, oh, so he's going to coach you. What's wrong with you? You lazy? Get your behind up there and do that work. Peter don't know how to talk to you, because Peter ain't no coach. Peter only supposed to fight. So Peter ain't going to know how to talk to you, because Peter don't know how to talk to nobody without fight. Peter used to confrontation. And when you got these people in positions on your dream team and they're out of position, that's why your life is jacked up. Because you're on the phone telling somebody who was never ordained to be a part of your dream team as your confidant. And that's why your business, your personal stuff that you didn't want to get out, got out. And you got your sponsor supposed to fight for you, and when there's confrontation, they're not an advocate. So when somebody talk about you, you get mad at them because they didn't say nothing. They ain't trained to say nothing. They trained to give you a check, give you money, and find money. They're not trained to fight for you. So you mad at them because you think they should have fought for you. So when you got these people out of position, that's why your life's so jacked up. Somebody came up to me and said to me, well, how much money did your sister leave you? You ain't none of my confidant. You ain't even my financial advisor. Hello? I looked at them. I said, excuse me. I don't think I put you a part of my dream team. He was like, what you talking about? I said, study it. Because every now and then somebody will come up on you and try to be a part of. Because when you form your dream team, it don't happen overnight. These people have to be proven from years of experience. You got to go before God and say, who are supposed to be in my circle? Who's supposed to be on my dream team? Who's supposed to be the part of the infrastructure, the foundation of who I am? So therefore, I know who to go to. If I need wisdom, you go to the mentor. They got wisdom. They know more than you. You can get on the phone and talk to them about stuff. But you don't play with your mentor. You don't disrespect your mentor. You don't call your mentor by their first name. They ain't that kind of team, huh? You don't get comfortable with your mentor that you be like, hey, Sal, no, 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 no. You don't go in there and tell your mentor all your stuff, your nasty stuff, but you might have said something to your friend. Let me tell you about my husband. The mentor don't need to hear that. The coach is there to push you. Why he pushing you? You're not supposed to be telling your business to the coach. That's what's wrong. Y'all going in the beauty parlor and the nail salon and the hair salon, and you're telling all your business to somebody who ain't been proven. And they know somebody who know you, and they know somebody who know you, and you know somebody who know you. My husband, I was talking to him, and a lot of people say, well, my spouse is my best friend, and I tell him everything, and we do everything. Well, you know, I was talking to my husband about something, and the way he reacted, I was just like, now, my friend wouldn't have reacted like that. He said, I ain't your friend. I'm a man. I'm your husband. So where I might be crying and getting all emotional, my friend is going to yield to that girl. You're going to be all right. My husband's going to be like, what's wrong now? And then we're going to get upset. He's so non-emotional. You just, look at you. You don't even care. I'm all upset. He said, you always upset. That's not my job to yield to your emotions. I'm your man. I ain't none of your woman. He said, because if you up there acting up, tell me, oh, Lord, and I look at you and say, oh, Lord, you won't call me a punk. I'm your husband. Call your girlfriend. Go talk to them. Then come back and we'll just find out what happened. Are y'all getting this? Your marriages will be better because you won't put, unnecessary expectations on your spouses that they're not capable of handling. They're not built to handle it. You can give them an update of what's going on with you. Because my husband look at me crying, and he'll be like, you all right? Because he's not thinking like that. You all right? You tell him you all right. Then the next day, you'll be like, I wasn't really all right, but you said that you were all right. And you said, when you said you were all right, I thought you were all right. But your sister would know you ain't all right. I could look at you. Some ain't right. Some ain't right. Come on, let's pray. My sister passed away, and I told my husband, I said, I was going through. He was just like, but she died like February. You not getting over it? You'd be almost mad, like, I can't believe you said that. But then God said, I didn't wire him. He's wired to be the head that when you deal with a situation, okay, she died. We had the funeral, had the home going. We prayed. We rich. So what is there to talk about? And in his mind, he's thinking, you still back there? He looking at me, what else is that? You still dealing with that? Why? We see the end. Why? Well, you go talk to your girlfriend and be like, yeah, you know what? I understand, girl. Oh, I know, because I lost my mom. Let's pray. Let's believe God. And see, when you understand that, then you won't have friction in your marriage. Isn't this good? And then y'all won't be sitting up there trying to get your children to be your friend. That's unnatural. That's not healthy. Your children don't need to know what's going on in your marriage. The intimate stuff like that. Yeah, they're talking to your kids. They're 10 years old. You know your daddy, he just did me so wrong. You're dysfunctional. No, daddy coming home. Daddy, why you did mama wrong? Wait a minute, you 10 years old. You're putting them on the level of an adult. My mama was older than me. And no matter what she said to me, even if I was an adult, that was still my mother. And she could fuss me out and I didn't say nothing. But you're trying to be friends with them and they're going to talk back with you. God spoke to me and said, in this day, in this time, he says, life will be so much better. When God gave me this revelation, it changed my life completely. So when stuff come up on me, I just look at my dream team and say, which one of them I need right now? Do I need some money? Let me call the sponsor. And that's what's wrong with y'all. Everybody in your circle broke. I was riding down the street when I was younger in the Volkswagen. Y'all know in the 70s, just riding in the Volkswagen. We stopped at Church's Chicken, only had $2. Got us 2 pieces of chicken and 2 biscuits and split it. We scraping up pennies. One day, and here I am, wasn't even saved. One day I was looking, I said, wait a minute. They broke, I'm broke. Some got to change. I said, I ain't hanging with them no more. I got to hang with somebody who ain't scraping so they could bring me up. I'm in the classroom and you dumb and I'm dumb. You don't know what's going on and I don't know what's going on. I tell all my friends, I ain't your friend in this class. I'm sitting up there observing who's the smartest person, because that's going to be my friend this semester. I ain't hanging with you. You making F's. I'm making F's. I need to get with somebody who's going to bring me up to the level where I want to go. You got to get out of that. Go with somebody who understands finances and monies and they doing something that you will be able to call them and they could give you good advice and even about monies. You broke, she broke, they broke, he broke, all y'all broke. And that's what we mess up at. Because we feel comfortable with being with people who like us. But God, you notice God always, when he ordained marriages, he always have them marry somebody that's the opposite. Because if you marry somebody just like you, that's why y'all can't get along. I'm a go-getter. My husband take his time. But that brings balance. Because sometimes when he taking his time, I'm like, you need to step up. And sometimes when I'm moving so fast, he say, you need to slow your roll. So it makes a good team. Could you imagine somebody always, you drag your feet, he drag your feet. You want to know why y'all ain't got nothing. Where you want to do today? Wherever you want to do today. What you want to go? Wherever you want to go. You think we should take this? I don't know what you think. I don't know what I think. What you think? Ain't no leader. And you want to know what you ain't got, why you ain't got nothing. Oh, you got somebody that's fast. Honey, let's go. Every week, you got a new get-rich-quick thing. Y'all are fine. Now you want to know why you broke. You don't invest in everything. Amway, Avon, Mary Kay. You got to have balance. When you got, you know, you have children. I got 3 kids. This is a perfect example. I got 3 kids. Every spirit you need to deal with, you dealt with it at home. When you conquer them spirits at home, you're ready to conquer the world. That's why God says, deal with a man who does not understand what his home, can't manage his home. There's no way he's going to manage my house. Because those people not going nowhere. Every spirit in your children, your husband, the cat, the dog, every spirit. I have 3 kids. Oldest son. He get money, he just feel like he got to buy something. Second daughter, she still thinks she a queen. She ain't a queen yet. whoever supposed to marry her ain't married her yet. So she thinks she's supposed to be in first class and stuff. You in law school. Hello, school, not job, school. Then the baby girl saved all her money. She got at least, she worked a minimum wage job and saved over $10,000, all in the drawer, under the mattress, in the bank. I mean, manages her money. So who do you think we're going to leave in charge? It ain't got nothing to do with no who the oldest. The one in the middle, my son would be done talk to because she got a good heart. She cry when she see a cat or something. And my son be done talk to her, he smooth talk. You know, mama left that money. You going to give me, get, you know, I just need $20,000. She'll give it to him. But that baby girl, I don't care what kind of thing you are, write it down. He come in there, baby girl, let me borrow some money. Okay, but you going to pay with interest. And she make him sign a paper. So he came to her and he said, I need you to pick up my son tomorrow. She said, not till you pay me my money. You still owe me $30. He said, I ain't got nobody to pick. She said, I can't do business with nobody who ain't paid me my money. You need me to pick up your son? Pay your debt first. Next thing I know, he done gave her that money. Who you think we gonna leave in charge? It's the baby girl. That's y'all problem. You know your grown son, irresponsible, almost 40 years old, don't do what he's supposed to do. You got the nerve to gonna leave him everything. Everything you work for gonna be gone in 2 days. Know them that labor among you. Know them. So you got 3 different personalities. You got the baby girl who want to move out. You got the second girl who want to be a lawyer, and she want to move out. You got the son. We had to give him a deadline. You move in January. He said, why? What do you mean, why? Tell me, I like it here. I'm paying rent. Get your own place. So you know them that labor among you. Then you don't get frustrated. You don't tell a son you got no money. There are people you shouldn't tell you got nothing. They already in your pocket. There are people who happy for you and never want to ask you for anything. So see, in closing, we get our own self in trouble because we pick the wrong people to be a part of the dream team. Let's stand. There's a part 2 and 3. I have to come back a later date. Pastor Apostle, this thing changed my life when God gave me this. And guess what? With the proper dream team, you win. That's why the Miami Heat won. It wasn't that nobody else wasn't as talented as them. They realized they put a team together that was able to take care of every part of their weaknesses. And they knew, y'all got to get this, they knew when the position changed and they needed to move out the way. When LeBron came to Miami, that was Dwayne Wade's team. It was big of Dwayne Wade to realize, I don't have the capabilities anymore to be ahead of this Miami Heat. And if we're going to win, I need to step back and take on another role and give it to LeBron. LeBron, Dwayne was messing up. Y'all listen to me now. This is good. Dwayne was messing up. The media was attacking him. They asked LeBron to comment. He said, I have no comments. After the game, he went and sat down with his friend. He said, listen, don't let that mess you up. You got it. You still got it. Now, let's just shift some things. Now, how you go from messing up and the next day, you the high pointer? Because the dream team coach didn't kick you to the curb. told you to go on out there and do your thing. When it got to the point that everybody was tired, they looked at LeBron. LeBron said, okay, I know I got to step up to the plate tonight. So y'all just give me the ball. He's a one-man show at this season, yes. Whoever's going to win tonight. Y'all be sitting up there, you just want to take over. Yeah, take over. We're going to win. Take over. Because when they won, they did not win as an individual. They won as a team. So for you to win, she wins. If she wins, you win. And that's what we mess up at. We think that we're the only ones in this, but we're in this as a team. So when she hurt, we hurt. Because when we get to the finish line, we all win. And guess what happened? They all got a Super Bowl ring. Even the water ball, the water man got a Super Bowl ring. The chaplain got a Super Bowl ring. The wives got a Super Bowl ring. Everybody got a Super Bowl ring. And they got the same ring. David had to go to Ziklag. Y'all got to get that. David went to fight. And there were some folks that was weary. He said, y'all stay back. Went in, got the spoils, came back and distributed. And then the folk who fought with him got mad because he gave the same amount to the people who stayed back. He looked at them and said, don't get upset that we all in this together. We're a team. So it would have been crazy for LeBron to get up there and diss his own player. When the church gonna learn that when we talk about each other, we're dissing our own player? And this is something that you need to go back and you need to get before God and look at your infrastructure. You might have to move some things. I remember you play something softly. I remember one of my friends came to me, and I went to a graduation, and I had already prayed and asked God what to give this person, her daughter, for graduation. When I got there, the mother called me on the phone, and she said, "I'm gonna need you to give me $587 for the party," just like that. I called her to the hotel. I said, you remember you had all that money one time? She said, yeah. I said, why are you broke now? She said, because I gave it away. I said, so you trying to put me in the same situation? I said, no, the way God deal with money, it don't work like that. I said, you knew you couldn't afford this party. You shouldn't have had it. And when I came to the graduation, you had a vision for my money? Well, I'm not your Jehovah Jireh. I said, now, I had $700 to give to your daughter. You asked for five. I tore the $700 check up and I gave her five. You shortchanged your own daughter without trusting God. Now, let me just explain to you. You don't have the leisure to come up and ask me for monies like that. You talk to God. And let him speak. And if he doesn't speak, then I'm not your answer. Because you'll be gonna sit around and be broke. And that person said, when I get restored again, will you help me with my finances? I said, most certainly I will. Because you'll be surprised how many people make you the Jehovah Jireh. Just because somebody got some money, you should ask them how they got it and teach you how to maintain it. You should want your own. How many want your own? I want to pray for you today. Pray for the apostle as y'all go into this next phase. This is why we have such unhealthy ministers, because they don't have a dream team. If you're ministering, the reason why you got some jacked up football players, because everybody, they make good money, and everybody on their team suck up to them. Nobody tell them what they wrong, because they on the payroll. That's why they so dysfunctional. Same thing with pastors and leaders. Nobody don't make them accountable. Pull them in and say, listen, that what you just did, that's not good. God, they let them get mad. But we got to be accountable so we can have a healthy church. This thing has literally changed my life as far as my dream team and how I'm looking at things. And when I see things don't work out, I say, God, this I need to tell you the revelation too about Judas. God says he created good and evil. If it wasn't for evil, Jesus wouldn't have died on the cross. It took evil to bring God's purpose to pass. So there are times when evil will be presented to you, and it's not a bad thing, because he said all things are working together for good. So God will look at an evil situation. He sends it out there for a purpose. And you need to say, God, why am I encountering this evil so I could handle this and show me how it's going to work out for my good? Then you won't get upset when people do stuff to you, because they could not do it unless God allowed it. My sister was evil to me. She said, I'm jealous of you. Why are you here taking care of me? I would never do you like that. I said, you don't have to do me. She said, why? I said, because I have a team that if I get sick, first of all, my husband gonna take care of me. Secondly, the kids gonna take care of me. And I have friends who will be fighting to take care of me, because that's the type of relationship I build. So I'm not expecting you to do nothing for me. I wouldn't expect, you don't have the servant's heart to serve me. So I'm not putting no expectations on you. Who wants somebody wiping your butt when you sick mad? Move on over there. Stink self. You stink self. And you trying to get healed. Y'all, now we being real. How many of you know it's the truth? Oh, you stink. I can't believe I'm doing this. When you going to get well? God put people in your life that love you, and they take pleasure in taking care of you. So see, that's where we mess up at, because we're putting stuff on people that they are not capable of doing. So we need to stop it and let people be who they need to be in your life. And know them that's supposed to be there and those that not. Stop trying to make things happen. And you know what's so crazy about it? Is that, because I'm writing everything up, Jesus had a dream team. And everything that we mentioned was in there. God was the one that he went to, but he also was accountable to John the Baptist. He had Peter. He had the ladies that sponsored him. Mary Magdalene came in there with some money. He had his beloved John. He had the three people that he had, the Peter that fought for him. Come on. Jesus had a dream team. He had Judas. In fact, he said, Judas, go quickly. Quick. Do what you've been called to do. Y'all, it is awesome. He gave him permission. Quick, do it quickly. Isn't that something? So Jesus had a dream team around him. And that's why he was so successful in his ministry. He couldn't even do it by himself. He needed a Judas to betray him so he could go to the cross. Oh, this is so good. This is so good. He needed monies on the earth to sponsor him. Wow. Because when he died, don't you know those, why you think those ladies were the first one at the tomb? Them were the money people. They were trying to figure out what we're going to do with his body, because he ain't had no money now. What we going to do with it? They were making sure that everything was cool. But you see? So I want you to just today begin to just rethink and retool and refire. Let the fire come back in so that you could be who God wants you to be. And you got to be a dream team, because when you get this together, we won't have all that counseling done. People won't be able to get you out of church so quick. You won't be wavering so much. Up and down and down. Then God can trust you with finances, because you'll become healthy with the proper people in your on your team. You know, all those people on the dream team, they, at Miami Heat, they're all rich. And when they go out to eat, they be fighting who gonna pay for stuff. Y'all getting this? Oprah, as much money as she has, she couldn't do the television thing with Tyler Perry. Are y'all seeing this? This woman is a billionaire, but she couldn't do what she needed to do without Tyler Perry, because everybody got to have the right team. You got to have people who organize things, the sponsor, know how to pull things together. You can't have a program without having the people on the back who knows how to organize stuff. So you got to pull it together. And that's what's going on with you. You're in a relationship with somebody who's not capable of being a part of your dream team. You got people on your dream team broke as you. They jacked up. They messed up. And y'all thinking alike, and your thinking is off. So it has to change. So I want to pray, and I'm going to get out the way. There's a part 2 and 3. This thing is so good. This really helped me out. So let's just raise our hands right now. And let's just talk to God. Just begin to talk to him about changing your infrastructure. My God is awesome. He can move mountains. Keep me in the valley. Hide me from the rain. Come on and tell him. My God is awesome. Heals me when I'm broken. Strength when I am weakened. Ever he will reign. My God is awesome. How many of you know that? Awesome. Come on and just tell him now. Awesome, awesome, my God is awesome. Come on and just tell him now. Awesome, 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 my God is awesome. Savior is awesome. Today I am forgiven. The grace is why I'm living. Praise his holy name. My God is awesome. How many of you know that today? Awesome. Come on and tell him now. Awesome. Well, he's mighty. He's mighty. He's mighty. He's mighty. let's join hands right now. Thank you, Father. And I want you to understand that that's just not a word that we should throw around. That means that everything that you need today, he can provide it for you. The Bible says he's the same yesterday, today, and forevermore. Nobody could explain how a person is old. He's the Ancient of Days, but he never get old. He is just God. There's nobody in that category. Nobody can compare to him. And it is not God's will that any should perish. And that means even perish financially in any areas of your life. We just got to apply principles to our lives and stop trying to live by miracles and whatever else come around I need God to perform. We got to start getting a hold to this stuff. And God can look at us and see some stability. And then he'll know it's time for me to meet all of your needs. God's not going to give us millions if we don't know how to handle it. So we got to go in and tighten up our stuff. I don't know. So they put something on him that he was not willing. He was like, this is crazy. Who I'm going to? I don't even know where the wedding is. I'm in my first wedding. We're having people do stuff that don't even understand the purpose of why they're doing it. And we got to learn how I got to give you this while you're standing. You got, this is another part. Thank you, Lord. I got to tell you this. Y'all don't want me to miss out on nothing. No. You don't want to miss nothing, do you? I got to give this to you. There's one thing that we definitely have to do is we got to learn how to be loyal.
Amen.
People are not loyal anymore. You got to be loyal to your leader, loyal to God. Not only loyal, you got to learn how to honor. I'm not talking about people who force you to honor them. I'm talking about honoring them because you see the God in them. And you want to honor them. You want to do it. And then you don't have a problem obeying. And then you don't have a problem in following. We got to stop following people who ain't taking us nowhere. I went to a church, And I've been knowing this friend of mine for a long time. We started ministry together. He took me to his house. He's in a multi-million-dollar house. He told me he paid cash for it. Showed me all his cars. We got back to the church and he looked at me. He said, "What's wrong?" I said, "But your people don't have what you have. Why are you so blessed and they're broke?" And he looked at me, "What do you mean?" I said, "You don't have to invite me to the church anymore, but I got to tell you this. Something is wrong with the picture that you could sit there Sunday after Sunday, take offering from those people, and they don't have houses and they don't have cars. And you're sitting over here bragging over all the stuff you have, and your people broke and struggled. And it was their offerings that got you to where you are, because you were broke too. How could you lay your head down at night knowing your people losing their houses to give you money to make sure you are blessed? Knowing that they're losing cars, took their insurance money, took their college kids' college funds to make sure you blessed, and they still have nothing. Here it is, you've been in ministry 35 years, and they still, there are people in there had great potentials, and you robbed them of all of that. And you ain't never got to have me back again. At this point, I don't care. But you ain't blessed, man of God. That's not a blessing from God. You have raped the people, and God says you need to make it right, because if you don't, you're going to die a terrible death. You got blood monies you're leaving to your children that belong to the children of God. At least he listened if he fell on his face and repented. So what you think I should do? I said, you need to go back and ask everybody who broke, who losing their houses, and go in that $1 million bank account and go in there and try to get them out of their situation. Send some of them kids to school. Did Jesus tell the rich man that? He said, "If you want to follow me, give up all your riches." He looked at me. I said, "Them cars, you can't drive but one car at a time." And then people don't even know he lived way out there, because he lived far and hide all the cars. It bothered me, because when you're a true shepherd, when you have a true heart of God for the people, you look at stuff differently. You begin to look at it as God look at it. I don't want to sit up and lay my head down at night knowing that I took something from somebody who really did not have it to give. When you give true blessings into good soil, the person who's giving it is also receiving too. I'm telling you right now, there's no way I would come back here anytime this woman of God asked me if I didn't know her heart. We get along because our heart is in the same place. I've walked out of big ministries when I know they're raping people. They won't get my dime. I went to a church and the service was packed, and the young man was up singing, and he was one of the guest ministers. And so I got up and said, "God told me to do this." I gave the young man $1,000. The pastor got mad. "What you gonna give in the offering?" I gave it. I said, "God just told me you've been here singing and ministering. You're about to lose your house. So here's $1,000, and that's just a beginning. Now, you can't tell me what to do with my money now." Because when I lay my head down at night, I want God to say, "Well done, that good and faithful servant." Look at that person next to you and say, "We are going to another level." Say, "I got it now." Say, "The struggle is over." So, Father, I thank you right now in the name of Jesus that you will cause them to be able to have an insight on today of where they're going to go with their dream team, and lift up this great woman of God, that this church will never be the same. It's going to another level. We're not concerned about who left, but we thank you, Lord, because you're bringing a new generation in here. Yes. Bless the dancers. Yes. Bless the musicians. Bless each and every elder. And God, even her seeing the anointing that's on their life. And let her never want for nothing. I give you glory and honor for it, God. I thank you for this opportunity to be here to celebrate this great woman of God. I release what you told me to release. I've given what you told me to give. I want you to be able to say, well, please, my daughter. Father, let them not be the same. Let the testimonies come in. In Jesus' name, amen.